DJ FMI, and we're live here at VPR. Guys, I am so happy to be back. Like, it's just, we missed you guys so much. You don't even know.
I missed you guys, too. I mean, man, it's been a crazy few weeks. And then, you know, last week we had the whole shutdown with the building and the internet being restored or updated or whatever. But we're back and we're better than ever. FMI, you were looking adorable in the pink.
Yo, all right. Let me break it down for you. VPR, you cannot tell a grown man that he looks adorable, all right?
Oh,
I'm already
sorry.
I'm already doing enough with the pink. You feel me?
Sorry.
Like, I was pushing it. I felt like Cameron. I'm like, you know, me in November, it's Thanksgiving time. You know, I'm feeling right.
You look great.
You feel me? I've been trying to lose a little weight.
I love it.
I'm going to lose a little weight.
I absolutely.
Aw. I'm trying not to be ticked no more. You feel
I
me?
I love it.
Yeah. How you feeling, though? Because I know you've been going through it also.
I have been, but, you know, I'm just happy to be back. I'm feeling good. I'm glad that today is the last day of Mercury retrograde because retrograde has been beating my ass continuously for the last 2 weeks.
You don't understand how
it
just,
I do.
being in business, one,
yeah.
I've been getting hit more on that side. And more than anything else, like my personal life, I'm straight. You're all good. But
right.
in the business, it's like another mishap and another mishap. I'm starting to expect it now.
Yeah, it's frustrating. I mean, and you know that when you're going through retrograde and the planets are all misaligned and Mercury is doing its own thing, you're not really supposed to be signing contracts, any of those things, because problems come into play.
You should have told me
a lot
that
of things
of
with
month.
Electronics. Remember what happened last time? You lost a wallet twice. I lost my phone like 2 weeks in.
Yeah.
That was our last big retrograde. It's been hitting us hard simultaneously.
Yo, that's
hi,
so
Steffi.
True.
So,
oh man,
yeah, it's been a bit, but you know, this is my reprieve. I love to be able to come to VPR Radio and sit here with you and do what we do and talk to our guests and play the dopest music that you've never heard. So it's always an honor. Once I get back here, I'm feeling great. It doesn't matter.
And today, guys, make sure y'all hit that calling number 718-928-9960. Of course, if you want to join in on any conversation
Hi,
that we have,
Veronica.
You could join in live on air. Just
yes.
let me know who you are and I'll just buzz you in and we get right into it.
Yeah, because we love to have these great, you know, in-depth conversations
Word.
With our audience. So we'd love to hear what you have to say. Feel free to call in. I miss you too, Shantae. We're ready to have a great show. I mean, it's been a few weeks.
No. Kiana, I'm here for all the malarkey today. You feel me?
I
came
I
here to start
it.
Problems.
Hi,
Yo, let me tell y'all my morning. You know what? Let me not tell you my morning right now.
Tell us.
We got we have to get into the intro first and then we can get back into it.
Okay.
Let's do it right.
I'm with it.
Cool. So y'all rock with DJ FMI and of course the one and only
Qiana the Goddess.
And we're here at VPR Radio having a good time. But
yeah.
just listen to our intro before we get into everything.
Yeah, man. I'm definitely shut.
I don't know what y'all listening to, but where we at? Yes. Qiana, let's go. DJ FMI. Yes. Yes.
Uh-huh.
We here. Let's go.
Qiana, I told you I got you, baby. FMI, I told you we got
Not
you,
yet.
Baby.
VPR.
Qiana, feeling the queen on it. She's screaming it mean on it. She's swift with a beam on it.
Whoa.
Mean bonnet, flow like a stream on it.
Yes.
Even Mr. Clark Steele wouldn't have a lean on it. Word to my pop, Rubik's
what?
Cuban. Cuban Rubik's, I'm damn doing,
what?
I'm damn
what?
Ruined. Half human, 50% cybernetics. Half human, visualizing the past, I'm past
what
you.
What
beeping this spot, murder down, past
wow.
you. Funeral of your body viewing is down too. Uptown, heavy D and the boys, I'm damn grooving. Listen to the flow, EMI, Qiana and my DJ, FMI. XM, why the f*** would I be FMY? Upside down, down to the upside I. Qiana and my DJ, FMI. Let's go.
VPR Radio. DJ FMI. And my girl, Qiana, baby. We hear y'all. All day. Call up. Tell me what you thinking. What's on your mind?
Yeah. when it's up, 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 when it's up, up. Yeah, it's up, 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 yeah, it's up, up. When it's up, 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 yeah, it's up, up. I came in to see my guy, light it up, make it happen. If I wreck, leave the park, buy another off the lot, let me know, yeah. What's the score, yeah? Bigger always don't be better, just get more, yeah. We wanna have fun, we wanna turn up. We know that it's slick, this fire don't she say slick. She like it rough. Shout it tough, she from Charlotte. She going baby on baby. I'm here for a good time, not a long time. If it ain't VIP, I'm in the wrong line. Yeah, I'm an alpha male, you know the strong kind. I'm like Nipsey with the hustle, gotta own mine. Wait till your season come, then it's your time. Don't be greedy, use your head, the whole family gon' get fed. She told me she gon' kiss and lick and suck me straight to bed. I said, fine, but spread your legs, arch your back, you know I love it when it's up, 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 yeah, it's up, up. When it's up, 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 when it's up, up. Yeah, it's up, 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 yeah, it's up, up. When it's up, 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 yeah, it's up, up. Love and life overflowing my cup. Good vibes, I can feel in my gut. Don't be surprised when you see me push up. I got the glow. Hey, don't you know that it's up, 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 yeah, it's up, up. When it's up, 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 when it's up, up.
Wrist so froze, you know my neck all gold. This shit ain't just for show. Oh, don't come close, cause they might bite your tongue. Wrist so froze, you know my neck all gold. This shit ain't just for show. Oh, don't come close, cause they might bite your tongue. See me stack it up, little baby back it up. I see you in the club, I'll take you. She don't wanna rush it. Blue eyes think she rushing. We ain't in discussion. And then we start touching. My body so fine. She hot like July. In the summertime. I love the summertime. We can kick it all night. I promise that would be fine. You can come anytime. You can come anytime. It's so froze. You know my neck all gold. This shit ain't just for show. Oh, don't come close, cause they might bite your toes. Ah, wrist so froze, you know my neck all gold. This shit ain't just for show. Ah, don't come close, cause they might bite your toe.
My back is the wall, dog. make my own way.
We're all just trying to steal
this
game.
So the niggas
go,
hey.
My
back against the wall, dog. My back against the wall, seem like the whole time. Won't be riding. My life, I came up police, I was ducking and dodging. They ain't real, but I know they really ain't funny. Been crossed by my toes, man, I swear that you told me. I can't go outside, can't go out back. I ride them shots and still stay on me. I ride them shots and still stay on me, yeah. The whole time I knew, won't really ride. I made them so to them, I had my heart that I was sliding. How would it help me and the bros, we was really riding. I get new, I spend on anything, pull up by myself, I wouldn't play no games if we. If you know, I was slinging that heat, and I told mama that I was stuck deep in these streets. And then I think my past is really just trying to haunt me. Rumors around trying to say that I squeal. I've been told, look, all that hot shit get you them years. Interrogation, bull fight, a murder case. I'm a real put myself in a sticky situation. In a sticky situation. In a sticky situation. In a sticky situation.
Keep on your money. Set us all on me tonight. And everything is free of charge. Go in the bathroom, girl, and do the sound. I'll be right there to fuck you with this time. Had a time in your life.
Know the party starts when we walk up in the door. Ass in the air when the money on the floor. Gotta put in work, baby, show me what you know. If you want this cash, baby, show me what you know, what you know. She from Atlanta. Shorty bad body looking like a tantrum. Then I told her, you my favorite dancer. She a diva, not a keeper. Shorty acting like I need her. I don't need her. Shorty only need a visa. Give her blessings like a preacher. I'm a teacher, then I kick it like FIFA.
When I walk, I can't even lie. I don't know how to stop. Money flip, we don't know how to stop. We gon' cause a scene when the top chop. We ain't gotta talk, drip talk. See it when I walk, I can't even lie. I don't know how to stop. Money flip, we don't know how to stop. We gon' cause a scene when the top chop. We don't follow on some Instagram. I'm in space, hella blaze, in my wood 3 grams, in my spaceships, and I swoop down, and I walk with the socks, bitch, I'm Gucci down, to the side, drip, like I'm selling rocks, and my homie in the loop, she gon' hit me back, yeah, taking planes in and out, ain't no drought, you know what we about, you know we in route, run it up, look at, all this shit so slow, though, but it's moving fast. Shawty got an ass, you ain't got an ass. Gotta talk, drip talk, see it when I walk. I can't even lie, I don't know how to stop. When it flippin', don't know how to stop. We gon' cause a scene when the top shot. We gotta talk, drip talk, see it when I walk. I can't even lie, I don't know how to stop. When it flippin', don't know how to stop.
This way. All right.
What is going on so with you, FMI?
Yes, 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 yes. VPR, we are back, and it's a good day.
It is.
It's just. I'm just gonna say it's a good day. That's what it is. So, if you anybody watch news anymore, if like new, is news still relevant?
I mean, you know how I feel about the news because I'm such. You know, an empath. I'm not a big fan of having on the news because seeing people in despair and sad makes me, crazy. But of course, I have been keeping abreast on the impeachment hearings because they are quite entertaining.
You read my mind.
They're so entertaining.
VPR, I'm going to apologize early because I honestly, it's like every time I turn on the TV, the first thing I see is, you know, the impeachment
hearings.
And it's just rolling and rolling. I was sitting down with my grandmother yesterday, guys, on VPR, mm-hmm. right? I was sitting down with her. We were just talking. And
what do you call your grandmother?
Grandma.
Grandma.
Yeah,
I love it.
So I was sitting down with grandma.
Right.
And I'm like, yo, she's just like, you know what? She's like, I understand these impeachments are happening. And she's big on politics.
Okay.
Mind you, her age, she's there completely with it. But she was just like, man, I can't watch my soap operas. And I was like, you know what?
The novella.
You're right. She was like, it can't come on. I was like, you dang right.
It interrupts everything.
Yo, it's not even interrupting it because it is, you know, the backbone of America, politics. Yeah. It mm-hmm. is what it is. At the same time.
The backbone, air quotes.
Yeah, at the same time, I'm sitting here like, yo, how long does this process have to, you know, go on? Because it's like you watch countless people get arrested that are surrounded by you. Kiana, if everybody around me is getting arrested,
you got to kill the rest.
No, it's not even that. It's just, doesn't that say that I'm at least guilty or something?
Hello?
Because they're doing it in my name.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
This is what I don't get. Like,
I mean, it couldn't be clearer, but at this point, I'm like, okay, January is the whole new election. You know what I'm saying? So yeah. he's already been here.
It's just, he's been here and he's conquered it. You know, it's not that.
It's crazy.
It's more of a fact of every time something happens, he distanced himself from whoever. Look at him.
Or he'll fire them.
Or fire them. And it's just like, all right, we've seen him do it before. But mm-hmm. what I'm touching on here is the more this happens and the more we see him and the more these impeachment things go on, mm-hmm. I'm starting to think we're desensitized to all of it.
We are. I mean, first of all, American society, I feel, is desensitized to a whole lot and too much. And that's why we're okay with so much of the fuckery, excuse my language. But to be honest with you, from letting, not me personally, but a lot of people let their children play violent video games, watch, you know, highly sexualized content of like music videos and stuff. Young girls twerking at 6-7 years old.
Oh, gee.
Thinking that that's cute. Okay. Yeah. Right. Oh, look, do your dance. And then they like popping and locking it on the floor.
It is.
That's a bit much. You know what I'm saying? But they're repeating what they see because children are sponges. So if you cursing at them all the time, they're going to be cursing. If you showing them twerking, they're going to be twerking. If you're teaching them how to write, they're going to be writing, you know? So whatever you're showing them and teaching them is what they're going to take on.
Did you see that meme online where it showed like the African-American mother yelling at her child and saying, this is why African-American men are the way, you know, the way they are. You didn't see the meme?
No.
Because she was yelling at him in public and getting ready to beat him, and he was cowering in fear.
Right.
And they're saying, this is why African-American men act the way they act, and, you know, they grew up in a single-parent home. And that meme
That's a lot of accountability on a single mom. You know what I mean? Because to say that one thing is the reason that we have single households is beyond. Because if a mother weren't in the position, and I'm in no way advocating for mental or physical abuse to your children, because you have to be careful what you say to them. You are molding these children to become adults, and whatever they're dealing with as children, it's just naturally going to carry over, as we all do. We deal with traumas from our childhood. However, a lot of men, right? We've talked about this before, you know, always, like continuously. People are having babies. They don't even know one another. They don't even like one another. So now they're already at odds with one another by the time that they're pregnant. So by the time she gives birth, she hates him. He hates her. He's drugged her through the mud, you know, and cheated and this, that, and a third. Now she doesn't want to let him see his child, or he just steps out and says, well, screw it. I can't deal. Now you've got a situation where whoever she is, you don't even know how she is as a person, yet alone as a mother. Now she's put in a position to raise your child. That is the problem right there. Women not being women and men not being men, because these are people that have not been molded into adults, because they're coming from the same type of household and they're repeating what they see. They don't understand their value. Men are devaluing the women. The women are devaluing themselves, which is why they accept the bullshit, and so on and so forth. And it's on repeat. Hi, Jason Swanson.
And when I sit here and I hear you say that, it's like, the co-parenting thing is cool. Not everybody could be a co-parent.
No.
But when I think about it, I'm like, yo, you know, co-parenting is the norm. You know, shout out to DJ T.
It should be.
Co-parenting is the norm. And I'm just like, yo, dude, like.
But it's really not the norm. It's not the norm anymore.
In 2019?
In 2019?
How many people you know stay with their baby father or baby mother?
No, but I don't know a lot of people that co-parent. One parent or the other parent is against the other, and the child suffers.
So you're taking that. Okay.
I'm taking that stance.
Yeah,
so
that approach to it.
Co-parenting to me is not just the fact that you are not together. Okay. I have tried for many, many years to co-parent with my ex-husband. It's just not, it cannot happen. His
views are different from yours.
His views are different, and he just, you know, his angst about life is just so deep that it's just, there's no, nothing rewarding or enriching. So unfortunately, that situation is what it is. Some people are so hateful. Some people are so miserable because what they've been through. It doesn't make it excusable, because even if you put me in a position where you have done horrible things to me, if we have a child, and I've been here, I'm living proof of this, okay? And we have children together.
Yeah.
And we're no longer together. It's not about my personal opinions toward you. I just want things to work out for the children. So if we could sit down and I could say, hey, listen, we're having a problem with such and such. Or, hey, listen, the children need such and such. Or, hey, listen, I need you to come to. Right. And that's the problem right there. Immature people are constantly having children. They don't even know how to be adults, yet alone parents. You know, a child needs to have a mother and a father actively in their life. And that's where co-parenting comes into play, where you can just have enough respect for yourself, respect, love, and admiration for your child, and respect for one another to say, forget all of that past crap. We're not together now.
Okay.
Our child is important, or our children are important.
So let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
When it comes down to child support.
Hi, Alicia. Yeah.
Do you think there's a better way that we can now evolve from child support? Not saying that, you know, nobody had to pay, but a better way where both parents have to now come together as...
I think that is the better way, and that a lot of people do just work things out. You know what I mean? Within themselves. Like, they do. I mean...
I feel like with age changes that. Like, the older you get, you have more of an understanding. You know what I mean? Even if you can't...
Well, it's not even always so much about age. It's about maturity, right? Because you could be 40 and bitter... And you could be 20 and bitter.
I know a lot of
and you could be 30 and bitter. And anybody that's bitter is probably just going to want to take the person's child support to get whatever max amount. Instead of saying, this is what I'd like to work out. Sometimes you might be able to get more just sitting down and working things out and letting them understand these are the expenses for the child. You know, but not every man will play that game either. Some men are like, I'm not going to give you anything. And then you're forced to take them to child support.
Dame Dash has had to pay over $1 million in like two children for child support.
That's, I mean, I don't know that story. I don't.
Recently, that happened.
The child support system is such a setup, and I don't know people's personal stories, right?
Of course, yeah.
But my personal opinion, and having lived through these situations, literally, so I'm speaking from experience, is if you are no longer with the mother or father of your child, and you are the sole parent, right? You should do your best to work out an amicable situation financially, mentally for the child, and just on the same, on being on the same page, i.e. this is when you're going to get the children. If there's holidays, you know, break up some of the holidays. You get them Thanksgiving, I'll get them Christmas, and next year we'll switch, because you need to institute that fairness. You want to offer your child the ability to see their father or mother as often as possible. Don't talk badly about the other parent at any time, because that's disparaging.
That's what Facebook is for.
Okay. That's not what Facebook is for. Because Facebook, anything that you put on internet
stays
forever, and you're making yourself look dumb. So don't down the other person. It sure is. And it'll remind you every day, like, oh, remember 1 year ago? Remember 7 years ago? Remember 4 years ago? I'm like, damn, Facebook.
They know my life more than I know me.
But it's important, but not every situation is going to be like that. And that's because not everyone is mature. So a lot of times you don't get the ideal, and you get people being dragged in court, or you get people that belong in court that aren't in court, or you just have absent fathers that don't pay for anything and just disappear and have other children.
You
have so many bad situations, but ultimately what you have are children growing up without one stable parent, yet alone two.
You see, and the only way I could add to this conversation... You. You got to watch who you lay down with, VPR.
Yeah, man.
Like, you have to understand the person that you lay down with, yeah, they might be bad, whatever the case may be, but you got to see what they bring to the table.
But they're probably bad, too.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
I always heard one line from hip-hop that stuck with me forever at any moment. J. Cole said, I only mess with women that got to lose. A woman with something to lose, a man with something to lose, meaning a career or, you know, a family.
Right.
They have value. They have, yeah, you know what I'm saying?
That's true.
So you got to watch who you lay down with, man. Because that one night, bro, really turns into 21 years old, depending on different states.
Yeah.
23 or 24. Depending on different states, you know how it go. But
yeah,
that turns into that. Where you got to deal with someone that you only lay down with once, bro.
Right.
Or, you know, we lay down with once. It's not worth it. It's not worth it.
You have to be careful. And you have to know the person that you're with. You even have to know the person that you're marrying. You know what I'm saying? Like, you have to be aware of who that person is inside and out and the type of parent that they will be. I mean, ideally, before you are having fully unprotected sex, you should be talking about, well, what would happen if we were to become parents together? What's your ideal in, you know, being a parent? What's your ideal on discipline? What do you think about spanking? What kind of church? Like, all of these things, as if you're going to be getting married.
It matters, man.
It matters.
Big time.
Because if you don't have the same visions for life, what are you doing? Now you're going to create a child that you guys have to share and pull and tug back and forth to get that child to conform to each of you guys and your individual ideas because you couldn't come together and figure it out beforehand. That makes no sense. Shout out to William Barnes.
Yo, shout out to everybody that's tuning in right now. Make sure y'all head to Radio Free Brooklyn at VPR Radio, at DJ FMI, at Qianathegoddess.
Yeah, man.
And follow us. We appreciate it. And you can DM us if you're going through something in life and you want to talk to us. You know, keep it respectful. I'm going to keep it respectful with you.
Right.
And we're just going to go from there. Okay. But yo, Qiana, have you seen the nominees for like the Grammys?
No, I haven't actually.
I'm actually
happy.
Fill
me in?
I'm actually a little bit happy. A lot of young artists have like the nod and they're getting nominated for a lot, like YBN Cordae. He's more of a, I would say, a J. Cole type rapper. Mm-hmm. I would say that. Billie Eilish, I think that's how you pronounce her name. I don't know that little girl.
I don't even know who that
is. Yeah, but now she's one of the biggest stars on this planet right now.
Oh, wow.
If you ask your kids right now, they would tell you.
My kids are different.
They're different. Okay.
They're different. Okay. They listen to like different stuff.
Frankie Beverly?
Naya loves, yeah. Some like loves the old disco. Naya loves K-pop. You know what I mean? So she's on a whole new wave.
Yo, I had to DJ
K-pop. I never know what Jordan's gonna pop out with. His music is just like Winter might know. Winter's always in the know. She's my young trendy girl.
When it happens, it's just they're nominating a lot of young artists, and I think that's lovely. You know
I
what
do
I'm saying?
Too.
Because Nipsey Hussle got nominated for so many awards.
Yeah, I mean, but it's a slap in the face because this is always what happens after, you know what I mean? Like, after their death. Like,
damn.
If it's posthumous,
it's true. Like, you can't get that love.
Does
when
it really
alive.
Count? Like, why are we not giving them their roses while they're here? You feel me? Like, I know he went platinum and all of that. What happened beforehand, though? Did nobody realize how dope of an artist Nipsey Hussle was and the tale that he was telling from the streets?
Qiana, you know what happened to me last week too?
What happened?
This is because you're touching on music and everything like that and people's legacies.
Yes, they do.
Yo, VPR, I'm going to be honest with you. All right? You got to listen to me clearly. I'm a DJ, so I should know every song. I know y'all think I know every song. Dude, no. Okay? If you pull up to my car, I'm listening to country sometimes.
So right.
You got to catch me in the right mood. But what I'm saying is, I didn't know the song Juicy was a
right.
sample.
Right. That's right. I remember you said that to me.
I was like, what?
How do you not know?
But let me drop the bomb. VPR, do y'all know Juicy was a sample?
I think they all knew. Does everyone here know that Juicy from Big was the sample from the original
Juicy Fruit, right? I'm like, what?
Right.
That's a thing?
That's a whole thing.
And then I started, because I've been DJing a lot of 50th birthday parties, and you know I've done them in the past, but
yeah.
That's when you get all the good,
and you'll be like, everything was a sample.
That's what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. So I'm sitting down now, and I'm actually just listening to it leisurely. Because normally I'll play records just to play records. I'm a DJ. I don't have time to listen to every record. I just catch a vibe, and I go. But I'm listening to like 70s and 80s music. I'm like, yo, this sample is from this. Foxy Brown sampled this one for that.
Oh, hell yeah.
I'm like, did he sample this? Another record. And then I started to question. I'm like, was Diddy and Biggie ahead of their time? Or were they just taking what's been laid before them and just making it a hit? I think that's a discussion we got to talk about.
Well, I think it was a bit of both. And Diddy was a lot of the creative genius behind this because he was the one sampling a lot of the beats. But you also
So he was the Kanye before Kanye.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, Diddy was doing his thing. You know, when he had Bad Boy and he had that all together, he was definitely doing his thing with all of the artists, and the music and the beats that they were coming out with were lit at all times.
But doesn't that change the way you view him? Like, if you found out somebody wrote the first...
Have you ever considered starting your own podcast? Hey everyone, it's your girl Qiana the Goddess. When I was getting VPR Radio up and running with DJ FMI, we had so many questions about distribution on Apple, Spotify, Google, and all the other podcast platforms. We wanted to get sponsors and advertisers and a place to publish our podcast so there would be a central hub to access the audio. Then I found Anchor, and all our questions about podcasting and the next steps were answered. Anchor is a one-stop shop for recording, hosting, distributing, and monetizing your podcast. It's 100% free and super easy to use. Trust me, because I do it. Through Anchor, we've received distribution for VPR Radio on all major podcast platforms, and they even alert us to new sponsors. Every week, I upload our audio, and our audience can go back and access the shows in case they missed the live stream. I love it. Try it for yourself by going to anchor.fm/start. Sign up and get your podcast started the right way. I'm so glad we did, and I know you will be too. That's anchor.fm/start. Go check it out.
But I knew all of this, FMI, so I respected it for him being like the king of sampling. Like, everybody knows that Puff is the king of sampling.
I never knew that.
You feel me?
I thought Puff was just ahead of his time. I was born in the 90s. I thought he was ahead of his time. I just thought it was like, yo, he heard this and he put in
big. Steph said, I'm a tad disappointed. I'm sorry, you guys are so behind in understanding that this has been the case.
Yo.
From the 90s when they started it.
I didn't think they did this in the 90s.
Oh,
I thought
my
they were
God,
still creating those sounds, man.
Nah, they have been sampling.
That's wild, man.
But at the same time, sampling has been going on forever. Once technology evolved in music and everything wasn't live, people started sampling. And even if you go back to like old time 50s, 40s, 60s music, right? A lot of the beats sounded the same because a lot of things were played live or in the studio, and it was limited in what you could add to it instrumentally.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So a lot of the beats had similarities. A lot of the songs would even have like similar cadence and stuff. So things evolved.
So what's your excuse?
And now so the excuse is now people started saying, you know what? Remember that song from the 60s that was like a one-hit wonder? I wonder if we take a piece of this and put it in this, what it would sound like. And they started playing. And I don't think there's anything wrong with that.
You know who's a big culprit of that gets me tight every time?
Steph said, when the young are just finding out the truth.
Yeah,
yes.
That's
exactly what it is. And this today is the day that you prove to the world that you are a jit. Little baby, right, baby.
Say less. Record it. But what I'm saying is... VPR.
James Brown, absolutely.
VPR, a big culprit of that. Richard, I don't mind you sampling records. I get that. But sometimes you got to let it breathe. You feel me?
Yeah.
When Beyonce did the Before I Let Go, like, nah, I will never play it. No offense to you, Beyonce, but I can't play it.
Never. Please don't.
It hurt
it's
me.
So bad.
It's
but that's not sampling. That's redoing the entire song. Just like they're redoing all of these movies and like, okay, at what point does creativity now... just get locked out and you're just redoing things instead of coming.
They didn't need to remake Ghostbusters.
And I love the people that played in it, but that's not Ghostbusters.
It wasn't a good
You know what I'm saying?
At all.
They didn't really need to redo Rocky. You know what I mean? I'm sorry, Michael B. Jordan, but you know, you're great.
Wasn't Rocky.
But wasn't he in Rocky?
No.
Or was that
It was his own standalone movie, no? Creed.
Creed, oh, okay.
I didn't watch Rocky. I'm sorry. I don't like. Was it Sylvester
Stallone?
And
isn't Sylvester Stallone doing another Rambo?
Oh, he did. That was trash. I took my dad to see it.
He's 70, bro. Who are you chasing
now? His acting was horrible.
His acting has always been horrible, my friend.
He has one emotion, VPR. No offense. If you ever listen to this, I can't. You know, I just personally don't like it, but it's okay. Like, if I meet you, I'll shake your hand, bro. But at the same time, I can't. Like, I was telling my dad, I'm like, how are you enjoying this? I don't know. But back to what I was saying.
Everyone has been, like, from the 70s, they started that. They were sampling Motown. You know what I mean? And then in the 90s, they were sampling 70s and 80s. In the 2000s, they were sampling 90s. I worked with a producer where I saw him take a sample and put it into a song that I wrote, and we did it in the studio. He took a Timberland sample and just, this is what a lot of the biggest producers do. Plus, they also steal from other producers. We were talking about that the other day, but we're not going to get into all of that right now.
Okay? All I'm saying is,
but this is this industry.
Tory Lanez just dropped an album called Chicks Tape 5.
Okay. Right?
And what he does is he remakes R&B songs.
Right.
It's quite, it's cool. But like, the first time I heard Tory Lanez, Say It came out. You don't gotta do nothing, just say it. And then I was like, yo, this song is amazing.
Right.
Come
and
to
I'm like,
find
that's
out, it's
Jay.
A sample.
Right.
I'm like, VPR.
I think I put you onto that as well.
Yeah.
Prove It. Right.
And I was just like, yo, what?
Was Jade or was that Brownstone? One of them.
I would hate if I was an artist Jade. And my standout single was a sample. Because Juice WRLD did it too. Juice WRLD did it with Lucid Dreams.
Bing, same bing, thing bing, with Chris Brown. He did SWV's sample. But SWV was sampling Human Nature from Michael Jackson.
No, I know that because I do that in my set.
Right. So it's like, and Michael Jackson hadn't done that more than 10 years before their time. So 90s were sampling from the 80s.
Yeah.
80s to 70s, 70s to 60s, and so on and so forth.
I don't know, man.
Mimicking sounds.
I'm sick of it. I'm gonna just take Future.
Well, right. I'm
gonna take Future because at least he's gonna mumble.
I never mind the sampling because if you can do more to it, then I love it. Like I love to know that I have a little sample in the background, but you came with a completely different twist, right?
Mm-hmm.
However, I don't love all of the redos of the songs. I don't. I think the last great redo of a song was "Killing Me Softly." Roberta Flack, redone by Lauryn Hill and the Fugees, because she was part of the Fugees at that time.
Yeah.
That was the last time a redo on a song was like really, really great. Okay, because that was after Whitney Houston's I Will Always Love You, which was a remake again from 20, 30 years before that. So all of these things have been redone. Celine Dion, all of these great, great stars. Mariah Carey, she remade a Brenda K. Starr song, which is crazy because Mariah Carey used to sing backup for Brenda K. Starr. Brenda K. Starr is great, but Mariah Carey's voice is on a whole different level. So to think that Mariah Carey was singing backup for Brenda K. Starr is like, huh?
Just because you brought up her name. Guys, let's give a round of applause for Mariah Carey. This is her 25th anniversary of that damn Christmas song. You know, all I want.
Yeah.
Yo, nice. I respect her for that. 25 years. I'm like, damn. And this song has been playing ever since I've, like, grown up. I grew up with that song in every ShopRite,
exactly.
In every Walgreens.
But again, that's a redo of a song. She didn't create that song. She just did it. She did it the most memorable way. And we all love her version.
I'm done.
But
with
she didn't make that.
Well, I know that one, but right. Like, it's just all these songs, man. Like when I hear people sample stuff, I'm
like,
it's a cheat code.
Stephanie sounds like she's learning so many things. She's just like, what?
No.
She might have just learned that Lauryn Hill's was a redo. Go to the original Roberta Flack. Yeah. I got put onto that from old schoolers that were like, I know that song. And I'm like, how you know this song?
Yeah,
this is Lauryn Hill. They're like, that's Roberta Flack, baby. I'm like, who? Girl, you better learn your music. I was like, okay, I will.
Juicy Fruit. That broke my heart. It's gonna break my heart forever now.
You are so silly, FMI.
Yeah, I don't know, man.
I think you'll get over your broken heart.
Yeah, something like that. Hip hop is crazy. Hey, Qianna, what you want to get into?
Yo, anything, man. I just absolutely love it. Is it time for us to start calling our guests?
We can.
It kind of is.
It's 11:30, you know.
Yeah, so why don't we play a little music, take a little musical break, and then we'll get to calling these folks so we could give these interviews and such.
All right, definitely.
She was saying WTF to Whitney Houston.
Damn. Yeah, shorty said fuck emojis, I just want you to own me. Swipe right on the call screen, I just want you to text me. Don't leave me on scene, don't just come through and sex me. Don't leave me on scene, just text me. I just want you to text me. Don't leave me on scene, don't just come through and sex me. I just want you to text me, just text me, just text me. I just want you to text me, text me.
Shorty said, fuck emojis. I just want you to hold me. Swipe right on the call screen. I just want you to text me. Just text me, just text me. Remember when you didn't like me? Before you ever even liked me. Now we fucking on a nightly. Marijuana in the library. Yeah. No bra with the white tee. Caribbean, she a fine teen. She said she hated when I'm gone. Nah. She said she really wanna fight me. Woo. Why I gotta get a crazy text when a nigga miss a test for 1 second? Oh. All I'm trying to do is live his life. Do the music, I ain't bout no stress. I would never ever leave her around one. Stuck up on a red text message. All she thinking about is if I'm cheating, smoking fucking demons with the main weapon. I'm just trying not to spoil the love. I know that we got it, we way fresher. Like, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute. Let's do motherfuckers. Way better. In her mind, she be like, why? I thought this man was a nice guy, but then the text again, no reply. It's the same thing every damn time. Shorty said, fuck emojis. I just want you to hold me. Swipe right on the call screen. I just want you to text me. Don't leave me unseen. Don't just come through and sex me. Don't leave me unseen. Just text me. Just text me. I just want you to text me. Text me. Don't leave me unseen, unseen. Don't just come through and text me. I just want you to text me. Just text me, just text me. I just want you to text me, text me. Shorty said, fuck emojis. I just want you to hold me. Swipe right on the call screen. I just want you to text me. Just text me, just text me. Damn, girl, we got problems. How can I solve it? Yeah. I got the keys, so let's get it started. Whoa, us going back and forth, girl, this shit is retarded. Wait, you got the keys, and now we just sitting in parking.
Why?
We a drive on the way now. It's such a shit just got us way down. She crying every other day now. She said I never ever stay around. Girl, I knew you since the playground, so I would never ever play around. Girl, it's only been a week now, but I know you feeling weak now. I'd never ever ever leave town, but I'm torn overseas now. Every time daddy come home, I'ma make it scream loud.
Yeah.
And then you hit me with, what are we doing? Or what do we mean now? I always text you back, but it's not enough. Are you making memes now?
Shorty said, fuck emojis. I just want you to own me. Swipe right on the call screen. I just want you to text me. Don't leave me unseen. Don't just come through and sex me. Don't leave me unseen. Just text me. Just text me. Text me. Text me. Text me.
Turning off with DJ FMI.
3Q, you wanna beat?
Why you still hating? I got the title, if you want it, come and take it. You ain't ready for the shot, pump faking. Everybody playing games, but I'm about to get it shaking. Get it shaking. Let's get it shaking. Get it shaking. Let's get it shaking. I hope you get into the money if you can. I'ma show you what it take to be the man. Pull up to the club, 100 deep is the plan. When I say we all in, I ain't talking about the dance. When a shooter put the gun down, admire him. In the past, he made a living off of firing. I know exactly what it take for me to hire him. Cause for the right bag, I bet he coming out retirement. Me ducking a problem is unlikely. Jealousy is probably the reason they dislike me. I remember when they used to want to fight me. Now I need new haters cause the old ones like me. It's easy to fail when you got it hard. I'm trying to eat, why you want to see me starve? Think I gotta take them to school like I'm LeBron. Everything that you learning is free of charge. Damn, I don't know why you still hating. I got the title, if you want it, come and take it. You ain't ready for the shot, pump faking. Everybody playing games, but I'm about to get it shaking. Get it shaking. Let's get it shaking. Get it shaking. Let's get it shaking.
Yo, yo, you seen that shit? How you step up on the scene that quick?
Been killing the machine, spit quick. When I tell you I'm the best, yo, I mean that shit. It was written, young prison, come visit. Gotta listen to get the picture, it's so vivid. Brain swelling from all the wisdom, it's all hidden. Ain't no need for the biggest fitted, I can't fit it. You don't listen.
listen to nothing I'm trying to show you. Shorty said he too cold, bipolar. Even though you tripping, wanna see you grow older. If I gotta tell him, kill him, then it's probably with the shoulders. If you an enemy, ain't no hands shaking. Even though I'm chilling, we can always get it shaking. Party ain't a party till the club starts shaking. With the big booty, little booty, better keep it shaking. Damn, I don't know why you still hating. I got the title, if you want it, come and take it. You ain't ready for the shot, pump faking. Everybody playing games, but I'm about to get it shaking. Get it shaking. Let's get it shaking. Get it shaking. Let's get it shaking.
Big man. My shit, I can back it up. Anything moving, I clap it up. Nigga be lying, they cap. Just like a mummy, I wrap it up. I get the money and stack it up. They say that I'm crazy, I'm tapped. Told them he crazy, I snap. Fuck nigga, finna get slapped, for real. I put this shit on the map. I hit that lick back to back. The label's been calling like who Rob Atlanta. They need to go find him and bring that shit back. I like the beat cause it slap. Bitch, I'm the king of the cat. Niggas is dirty, if I do not fuck with you, I cannot give you no daps. Most of you rappers is pussy. I do not listen to raps. Bitch, I don't listen to lies. Bitch, I just listen to facts. I'ma hit a lick, I'ma flip that. I'ma go and get me a big bag. Most of my haters, they big mad. Man, fuck my haters, they big mad. I'ma hit a lick, I'ma flip that. I'ma go and get me a big bag. Most of my haters, they big mad. Man, fuck my haters, they big mad. Started out in the jungle. Fuck it, I couldn't be humble. I couldn't depend on no nigga. Nigga don't care if you hungry. My stomach been talking, I knew where to get it. I had to go stick up my homie. 150, I took all that money. That fuck nigga knew that he owed me. Sliding through the city with a big bag. Chopper on the seat and a ski mask. Diamonds on my neck, that heat. Tryna make a pussy nigga big mad. Hit it from the back, I'm a raw dog. I never fall off. Nigga, fuck the whole rap game. I'm tryna get a ball off. I'ma hit a lick, I'ma flip that. I'ma go and get me a big bag. Most of my haters, they big mad. Man, fuck my haters, they big mad. I'ma hit a lick, I'ma flip that. I'ma go and get me a big bag. Most of my haters, they big mad. Man, fuck my haters, they big mad. Big mad.
I'm letting it spread.
Yeah.
Whoa.
Conair. Whoa. YMBS. Whoa. Whoa. Where we at? We at VIP?
Ideal. Let's go. On the track.
Bumped in the shorty, spilled the drink on me. Goddamn, oh my God, I'm just trying to have fun. I was looking all flay. And you see me with my squad, hey. Now it's time for her to go, huh? Cause she just messed up my clothes, hey. And she just messed up the flow, huh? Look all these bottles I bought. Bumped in the shorty, put the drink on me. Goddamn, oh my God, I'm just trying to have fun. I was looking all flay. And you see me with my squad, hey. Now it's time for her to go, hey. Cause she just messed up my clothes, hey. And she just messed up the flow, huh? Look all these bottles I bought, hey. I'm in a club all day with utensils. Cause I'ma eat like a boss and you see the ring gloss. So you ratchets is mental. How the hell I even met you? You made a point and you marked like a pencil. I was trying to have fun, so forget you. I know you drink this not enough, I don't respect you. Damn, you was looking so good. But you messy, look Jesse, get back to your hood. Hope you just understood. Are you kidding me? Please don't security shug. I don't mean to be rude, but I'd fly if I could. I'd be minding my biz. Now the show here is over, this is bump to the show. Put the drink on me. Goddamn, oh my God, I'm just trying to have fun. I was looking off late. And you see me with my squad, hey. Now it's time for her to go, huh? Cause she just messed up my clothes, hey. And she just messed up the flow, huh? Look all these bottles I bought. Bump to the show, put the drink on me. Goddamn, oh my God, I'm just trying to have fun. I was looking off late. See me with my squad, hey. Now it's time for her to go, hey. Cause she just messed up my clothes, hey. And she just messed up the flow, huh? Look all these bottles I bought, hey. Look at my outfit,
so fly.
Shirt got a mocha Henny stain. How you spilling drinks everywhere? You got a hole in your lip, make it drip like my heavy chain. Rosé, let it shake, bout to let it rain. Got bottles in the models, going feel the pain. All my rushes, they be really bout to run the train. DJ, play the record, make it spin again. I was mad, but I'm over it. I be standing on the throne, looking over it. All this money keep on coming like I ordered it. And VIP, looking lit, cause I'm a shoulder there. Who is gon' pay? Always looking flea, got the Louis with the J. Whole club turn, you already know it's May. Everybody drink up, last make a move, hey. Goddamn, shorty's put the drink on me. Goddamn, oh my God, I'm just tryna have fun. I was looking off late. And you see me with my squad, hey. Now it's time for her to go, huh? Cause she just messed up my clothes, hey. And she just messed up the flow, huh? Look all these bottles I bought. Bumped in the shorties, put the drink on me. Goddamn, oh my God, I'm just tryna have fun. I was looking off late. And you see me with my squad, hey. Now it's time for her to go, hey. Cause she just messed up my clothes, hey. And she just messed up the flow, huh? Look all these bottles I bought, hey. Bumped in the shorty, spilled the drink on me. Bumped in the shorty, spilled the drink on me. Bumped in the shorty, spilled the drink on me. Goddamn, oh my God.
Send you a pack.
Narco.
Fucking to work, huh? Fans be plugging their shirts. Check them, I know what it's worth, huh? Culture knows I'm mafiosa. Bread around, I keep a toaster. Y'all know I can't shoot and drive. That's why I roll with a chauffeur. Mountains and white, you can ski on, huh? She wants to lean Dion, huh? Take a soda, make a neon, huh? I just be making my G on, huh? Money so tall you can lean on. When my eyes look like it's peed on. Police stop bugging.
How y'all feeling today, baby? How y'all feeling?
Send you a pack, don't open it up. Cause me on some transported shit.
How y'all feeling?
Construction to keep my hand on the bricks. I supervise while all the workers make sure the stands get lit. Yeah.
Pocket chip and narco trafficking.
Yeah.
Buy and sell, yeah, I got clientele.
Yeah.
Pocket chip and narco trafficking. Yeah. Buy and sell, yeah, I got clientele.
Hold on.
Yeah. What the fuck's a drug? Scorpio, no Drake, this from the Mexicans.
traffic, meet them checks coming in. Scripts not for play, this for medicine. Make your money all day, my regimen. Getting rid of weight till we skeletons. We be catching planes in the forest, switching lanes. Fly them out your way, we got pelicans. I was making plays straight out the Sheridan. Getting all kinds of cakes, we like enemies. Ancient sweet, yeah, we got sticks, but no cinnamon. Package it, then I call traffic it. Buy and sell, yeah, I got coin too.
Make sure y'all check out the track, Run Poison. All right.
Yeah, man. VPR Radio.
So, Qiana, can you hear him? No?
Guys, can you hear me? Charl and Coke, can you hear me?
They can hear you, Brandy Clay. Can you? Yeah?
Guys, can you hear
me? No, we can hear. I can hear them quite fine.
I can't hear them at all.
You can't? All right. Mm-mm. Let me turn up your headphone. All right. Do you hear? Take off your headphones, Qiana.
Coke and Charl, can you hear me? Yeah, I don't.
You don't hear them? Oh, man.
Are they like, in my headphones?
Guys, right now we're having technical difficulties, but I'm going to get a song on, but just keep going and we can hear you live. I can hear you pretty well. Let me get up that monitor a little.
Maybe it's.
There we go. Now that should sound a little bit better. Hello?
Sounds great to me.
Sounding great? Good. Still sounding great. Try the headphones out one more time, Qiana.
Hello? Can you guys hear me?
We can.
Yes, we can.
I can hear them fine.
I can barely hear them. Maybe turn them up? Hello?
Hello?
Yes, Qiana?
Yeah, I can barely hear them.
You can barely hear them. That's so crazy to me.
Yeah, I hear you great.
Wow, guys. All right. Give me 1 second. Give me 1 second. You can hear them in there? Anything better?
Yeah. Can you speak, guys?
Hello? Testing 1, 2.
They still sound very low.
Hello.
Yep. No, I could hear you pretty far. Oh, you went deaf just now?
Yeah.
Okay, now she hears you. I'm going to turn it down.
No,
okay, Qiana.
You, though. It's,
okay.
Theirs is too.
Okay, now I got you. Now, Qiana, try it out. Is it a little bit better?
Hello.
You can't hear them? Nothing?
Charl and Coke.
There you go.
There you go? Okay.
Yeah. Awesome.
Awesome. Guys, thank you for even waiting. Like, they're super patient.
Yeah.
I appreciate you. So how you feeling today?
Awesome.
Feeling awesome. That's what I like to hear.
Yeah, well, we are so happy to have you on the show. Good friend of mine and to the show Keir Worthy told me about you guys and about Urban Envy and, you know, how you guys are from the Midwest. And I wanted to learn more about your story and get into, you know, creating your own persona, your own show in Black Hollywood and what that's been like, what the creativity process has been like. Like, we want to know about your backgrounds. We want to know everything.
Oh, well, we're working class gentlemen from Detroit, born and raised, went to public schools here. This is Coke. I was educated in Detroit public schools for many years.
Right.
I just recently quit to pursue acting, writing, you know, movie making.
Amazing.
Charl is my best friend and my business partner. He was a well-known ballroom dancer. In the city of Detroit.
Wait,
let's not gloss over that. You said ballroom dancing?
Why? Wow.
Oh, yeah, one of the best I've ever seen.
Holy cow.
All right, my brother. Yeah.
Right, that's so different.
See, this is something I would want to see in studio. I would say, you know, come through and just do what you got to do. But,
right, but they're out in Detroit.
Of course, they fall, you know.
Yeah. So tell us more. Oh, tell us more, Coke.
Well, that's how the whole thing started. I was writing a story that just came to me in the back of my head. One day I was at school or at work, and I just started writing this spiritual piece, which I've never released. I was thinking about getting Morgan Freeman to do it, but we didn't have $500 at the time, so it was just a dream.
Right.
So Chuck used to come over and work out before he went ballroom dancing, like every week, every 3 days a week. And one day he stopped me and said, listen, man, I want you to write a story about my life. And the strange thing is, He never knew that I was writing anything. He never knew that I could even write.
Wow.
And the fact that he said to me, I want you to write a story about my life, so I figured, let's do it. I just said, consider it done. And that was called Mr. Ballroom, and it was a sitcom. It was a comedy. And so we did business with a company called New Show, and they went under. So we couldn't use Mr. Ballroom, so we turned Mr. Ballroom, the sitcom, into the movie, which is known now as Urban Envy, which had many names before we finalized it as Urban Envy. It was Detroit Coney, Detroit 313, and it got real serious real quick.
Nice.
No comedy at all in the movie.
Right, right. So tell us about how you segued from, you know, working in the educational system to saying, I want to really pursue my passions, because I feel like that's so admirable. And it really is a testimony to you saying, this is what I'm supposed to be doing. This is my dream, and I am going to live it, because it is such a big fear that most people have, you know, to put down the thing that's comfortable and that has provided them with so much security to say,
that comfort zone.
I'm going to do something that's uncomfortable, but something that I really, really, really love.
Absolutely. It was terrifying to do.
Yeah.
I walked away for 25 years.
Right.
And, you know, had a small child, had, you know, fiance, and I had money put up, but still, you want a check coming in every week.
So right.
It was terrifying. It took 7 years to actually quit. Mm-hmm. I was thinking about quitting for many years, but I didn't have that boost, that push. And once we started doing films, it just dawned on me, like, why am I making everybody else money?
Right.
When I can make me and my family a fortune.
Right.
Yeah,
I mean,
man.
We're not taught about generational wealth.
Talk
and
about it.
Dawned on me, because I have wealthy friends that are non-black, and they asked me a question like, why don't you guys do this?
Yeah.
You talk have all that this talk. Talent, why don't you do that?
Yeah.
And I'm like, that's a good question.
That's a good question, because we weren't taught to.
Not at
you
all.
Know, generationally, on average, and we talk about this on VPR all the time, we don't get something passed down to us. You don't get a house purchased for us when you get married and things like that, that, you know, a lot of Caucasian families
all.
And stuff do.
At all.
Absolutely.
You inherit debt and an old
yeah,
house.
You inherit debt.
Car.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. Exactly. So it's so unfortunate, and I really appreciate that you guys just said, hey, we're going to do this.
Take the leap
of
faith.
That started with Charl. That started with Charl when we paid someone else to shoot Mr. Ballroom.
Right.
And we got a six-minute trailer for $16,000.
For how much?
Yeah, we didn't
$16,000?
$16,000 for a trailer.
Y'all should have collared at me then. I could have gotten that done for you.
Sure. You got to live and learn, right?
Right.
See, Charles, I call him Chuck. This is my boy. So
yeah.
He said, never again will we take any slowing from anybody.
Yeah.
We just got played. We paid what they asked. It was hard getting the footage back. It was just a hot mess.
Wow.
We found out the gentleman was middlemaning us to fill his pocket.
Of course. And that's the worst.
He made a decision. He would never, ever, we'll never pay anybody else to do another thing for us, and we have not.
That's right. And you learn it.
And so he learned how to film on YouTube.
Right.
He taught himself how to work the cameras. He understands the camera a trained professional.
Right.
It's amazing. So I know it's God sent.
Yep. So you two are like the perfect pair, because you do all of the writing, the screenplays. He's got all of the directing and, you know, the cameras. And is it just you guys on a team? Do you have like an AP? Who else do you use when you're shooting?
Well, primarily it is us, and we subcontract little things out. We're actually expanding our company right now, but we have a few people that we can call and say, listen, man, we want you to boom. You're going to boom this whole film, this whole project.
Right.
We have a sound guy, but primarily it was just us. And we had a former partner before who helped out. He helped co-write Urban Envy also. But we no longer do business with him in that manner.
Right. It cool, happens. But, yeah.
Right. Oh, yeah.
So if you don't mind me asking, how do you balance your personal time with your work time? Because it sounds like you're busy. You know what I mean? And you and your partner are doing so much. How do you balance it? Because I know that's what must be hard on everyone else.
It's extremely hard. But I made a decision. Like, if I want my wife to retire and never have to work, I have to take that sacrifice now. I've got 25 years and some change. going to get a pension. I'm not relying on that. She can have that. But to answer the question more effectively,
yeah,
we just take it as it comes. Like, we have to deal with it.
Right.
I told her, give me 18 months, 18 more months. And I promise you, if it doesn't work out, then I'll go back and I'll work two or three jobs, whatever you want. But I have to set up some sort of generational wealth because both of our retirements together is not going to allow us to live the type of life that I feel like we
That's
were.
Right. I completely agree.
You have me blown away.
I love
away
the way
here.
You think, sir. Yeah. No, okay. Truly. I mean,
that sacrifice is something that not a lot of people are built for. You know what I mean? So when I hear you saying that, and you know, you sat down and you spoke with her and you say, just give me 18 months and you know, let me see what I get with it. And if not, then I'm back to the drawing board. Not a lot. Yo, that's a lot on you.
And that's a true testament to the strength of your relationship, too.
True.
You know, because that person, your partner, has to believe in you just as fully and say, okay, babe, like, I'm willing to take this leap of faith with you.
Yeah.
You know, wholeheartedly, because you can't do something like that halfway.
At
and
all.
Then step, you know, into arguments and be like, well, you don't have a job. You know what I mean? You have to be willing to be that partner.
She's about 90% there. Because,
yeah.
You know, she's a woman.
Right.
You know, she's a sister soul.
Well, I don't know what that means.
She's a
okay.
sister soul.
I don't know what either of those things mean.
Yeah, so,
but okay.
Some days are better than others. You know, sometimes she might not say it.
Yeah.
But she's like, hey, honey, listen, da da da. I'm like, listen.
Right.
Not a problem. I've been working all my life. I have a little money. We can do this or that.
Right.
But, you know, we agreed upon it. I didn't just up and quit.
Exactly.
So we're going to do.
Yeah.
But bills will be straight. But all the extra, you know, red bottoms.
Right.
All, you know.
Listen, sometimes you gotta take a minute to feed the dream. You gotta nurture that dream, and it needs to be planted, healthy. You know, put the money into an actual investment that's gonna return for you, because those red bottoms aren't gonna do anything but have the soles come off after you've walked in them enough. And then you have to repaint them.
Ooh, I'm going to say, Qianathegoddess, you went deep on that one just now.
I'm just saying, materialistic things aren't lasting, but generational wealth is. So,
we have to think like that as people.
For
and
sure.
In any people, whatever race you are.
Yep.
Especially if you're a person of color.
Especially.
Black, white, I mean, whatever.
Yeah.
If you have color, the cards are stacked against you. People don't want to admit it, but it's true.
Yep.
You don't have the same, you know, how can I say it nicely?
Opportunities, privileges.
How can I say it nicely?
I mean, I have a friend of mine, a very good friend of mine. They're Albanian.
Yeah.
And when each kid graduates from high school, they get $300,000.
Right.
You should see the weddings. I would know that. I know that. Like, I used to do valet, and they would come in all white cars, two different separate weddings.
Yeah.
And, you know, one for the woman, a party for the woman's family, and a party for the men, and then they come together. And we would make
bank. Their weddings are like $1 million weddings.
Oh my gosh.
All white,
everything.
And they get all of that back because people give them
and
so
the money
much money
right back at the, what you call, yeah.
Oh no, yeah, at the reception. They stood in a circle.
Yeah,
and
throw dinner, money at them.
And everybody threw literally a garbage bag full of $100 bills.
Right.
They were dancing on top of the money. I was like, I told
maybe
my daughter.
Maybe I need an Armenian husband.
I'm looking the wrong place real quick. You don't want one of them. They you know, you don't want that though. My boys, they be violent. Yeah. They don't want that. But yeah, we definitely get you,
some
man.
Of the nicest people you ever want to meet.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm talking, when people born with money, they don't have the same outlook or the same problems.
That's
that
true.
People who are not born with it. They just think differently. So they don't understand.
They don't.
Most of them, they don't understand the struggle.
They
so
don't. It's bliss. It's like ignorant bliss. Yeah.
Yeah, like you never have to worry about a bill like your life.
Right, exactly. Like, are you still paying for your car? You pay for that every month?
I always tell people.
You don't just buy it on the lot?
Seriously. I always tell people, if you want to see the difference the way people live, take a drive through a wealthy neighborhood, right?
Mm-hmm.
And look at the people in it. They're all doing whatever they have to do and minding their business.
Mm-hmm.
Then take a drive through the hood.
Yeah.
You ever notice when you drive through the hood, people stare at you through your car?
Yeah.
Like they live on alert.
Man.
You ever notice it?
No, yeah.
And it's only, they say it only happens. Yeah. They say it only happens in, you know, impoverished neighborhoods because, dude, you have to understand, they feel like they have nothing to lose.
Mm-hmm.
They already don't have it. So it's just like, all right, I'm going to be here forever. I'm going to get the project building that my mom, you know, lives in.
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna get that apartment.
Hopefully.
Which, yeah.
Yeah.
So it's Facts. Just, it's sad. Yeah. It's sad that, you know, you have to see that and you have to deal with that. You know what I mean? From any walk of life, any race.
Yeah. You never go to a wealthy or, you know, high echelon type of neighborhood and see people gathered at the store.
Yeah. Grilling you know what I mean? Or just chilling like, on a corner with nothing
chilling
to do.
Chilling on a corner. There's no corner chills. You know what I mean? It just doesn't go down.
No.
It doesn't.
You won't even see a liquor store.
I was about to say that.
You don't.
I was about to say that.
You'll see probably a high-end, like, wine store.
Yeah, wine and spirits.
Wine and spirits.
Yes. They call it spirits. You're right.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. It's so different. And it's, you know, it's unfortunate because that's the structure that has been placed in effect for us and has been very effective. So to see people breaking that chain, because that's exactly what it is still a mental enslavement, because a lot of people are still struggling but looking great on the outside, and you know, you got the Gucci label and this, that, and a third, but that's not something you can transfer to your child. That's not going to pay for their education. That's not going to, you know, take care of you if you get sick. So we have to think better.
You know, speaking on that, right, I was having a conversation this morning at Dunkin' Donuts. So it was a British lady. Strange. I was just standing there, and you know, we started conversating. And she's like, "You know what's the sad part? Mind you, we're in Flatbush, right? We're in Flatbush in Brooklyn." She's like, "You know what's the sad part? In a week, you're going to see a bunch of TVs on the corner, and the money that they're getting for claiming children, they could actually use it to actually, you know, put warmer coats on their kids and put it into the future." But you're going to see when Black Friday come along, you're going to see all that money in TVs, gadgets, this, that.
So true.
Instead of backing your children, where it actually makes sense,
where it belongs,
or investing in business. No. Yep. And that hit me, that this lady, you know, this British lady is breaking that down to me.
Yeah. And she's absolutely right.
Our priorities are screwed and I realize why.
Right.
When it starts at home.
Yeah.
And it's perpetual. If you feel like you have no hope, getting some Gucci's or Louis, whatever, it gives people like, I belong. I'm part of
I belong group. Somewhere else. Yeah, but the crazy thing is that you still couldn't put that person in a room with someone that really feels like they belong. You know what I mean? Because they're going to feel nervous. They're going to feel different, because that's not even, just because you put the label on doesn't even mean that you exemplify it. Doesn't mean that you have class. Doesn't mean that you understand it. Doesn't mean that you have any sort of, you know, information on like finances or business or anything else, politics, anything. So you just wearing it, but you got Gucci on though.
Yeah, you got the belt on.
As Charl would say, you can put perfume on a pig, but it's still a pig.
It's still a pig. Smells good though.
Yo.
So tell us about Urban Envy. I know that it's available on Amazon Prime.
Yes.
Right. Tell us about
tragic love story.
Okay.
Based around Charles' life, you know, loosely. A young man, working guy, works at Chrysler, whatever. He basically wins the ballroom competition through default and gets the big head, because ballroom is big in many areas. You know, it's huge.
Mm-hmm.
So all the women start liking him. He ends up dating my character's girl. My character is like sick in the head. Like, he only loves two things in life. And in this order, he loves his woman and his money. And he'll kill you over his money.
Right.
So he couldn't even imagine you looking at his woman.
Right.
So when he finds out loosely that this woman is interested in Charles' character, it gets bad.
Yeah.
And the twist at the end has everybody in an uproar, like, whoa, I didn't see that coming. There are situations where his character should have listened to his mother.
Mm.
And put those little
listen to your mama
nuances in the film so that people can relate to it. It's not one of those, okay, we're drug dealers.
Right.
We got strippers. We got a lot of money. There's no drugs, no strippers.
Right.
You know, we're tired of pushing that agenda.
Yeah.
We're tired of pushing that agenda. I'm tired of seeing it, but go ahead, my brother.
I don't like it at all.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
It is what it is.
Talk about that all the time. But you don't have to perpetuate it. Right.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Lenny, the main antagonist, my character, they don't know what he does for a living. They know it's pretty much illegal.
Mm-hmm.
No one knows this. I left it up to the audience to assume.
Right. He could be a politician.
Yeah, you never know, right? He could be a lobbyist for cigarettes or something. You never know.
I'm not going to tell you what he did, but everybody's going to be shocked. But he's not a very nice guy, but he loves his woman.
Right.
Charles' character, Marcus, is really a good guy. He lost his girl, the love of his life. And he's just feeling himself. He's out smashing different women, going back and forth.
Mm.
And it kind of bit him in the ass. Like, you know, be careful who you're messing with.
That's right. We were just talking about that, weren't we, FMI? Be careful who you lay with, all of that. Yes.
Oh, man. I'm glad that you touched on that.
Truly.
Hey, when you guys watch the movie,
I
might watch it tonight.
Seriously, I'm like, I got time.
Mm-hmm. Watch till the end. And my phone is always on. You can call me and we can kick it about it because we're working on like three other films right now.
Nice.
Right about that.
Film, and we have a kids film coming out. It's multiracial. We
got, great.
I mean, little kids, like 7, 8, 9, 6-year-olds. We shot it a couple of years ago. It was in post. We took this film to, well, trailer to the film, to the AF Film. And the AF Film is the American Film Market, which is hosted in Santa Monica once a year, every November.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. There are 700 distributors that comes out for the sole purpose of buying and selling TV, film, scripts, ideas, and everything.
Right.
So we showed it to the first four companies. The first four companies, they like, look, we need this right now.
Wow.
They didn't want the urban film. They were like, oh, take it to BET.
Yeah.
We have tons of them. We want this one.
Yeah.
They hit us in the gut with that one, but we have several different genres.
Right, right.
So the fact that we put something together, basically, Charl and I, this kids film,
mm-hmm.
on a very, very low
genius.
Budget, and they want it that badly. We have four emails. Since we've been back, we haven't been back.
Nice. Let the bidding begin.
Yeah.
Y'all right,
got it right with that. Let the bidding begin.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I know how that goes. How badly do you want it?
Yes.
Yeah.
Talk about it.
Right. I love it. Well, congratulations on all of your success. Really, really proud of you guys. If you're going to be in New York anytime, you know, soon, even in 2020, we would love to actually have you here in the studio because I know there's so much to talk about and to touch on.
Yeah, Chuck is not talking because he's at work, but I usually do most of the talking anyway.
Right, right.
So it worked out. It worked out.
Yeah, that's how our dynamic is. I'm the one, he's more like measure twice, cut once. I'm like, I can hit that with this rock the first chance.
That's okay, but see, that's the difference between being in the studio. Like, he'd be talking, I'd get it out of him. Wouldn't I, FMI?
Of course. That's how you gotta give it up.
That's a fact.
You
see what
I'm saying? You just gotta live with it. You gotta live with it.
Absolutely.
You gotta be a crazy person to think you're gonna outtalk a woman. It ain't gonna happen.
So tell me a couple of things. Where can everybody find you to follow you on social media? And how can they download or get access to the actual film, Urban Envy?
Well, I think you can buy it only on Amazon Prime at this time. We're looking to, you know, push it out on other platforms in 2020.
Mm-hmm.
You can find us on Facebook, Unico Entertainment. You can find us on
Instagram. Could you spell that out for the audience?
Oh, yes. Yes, Unico, Iniko.
Okay.
Entertainment. We're also at Unico Films. Are we at Unico Films also, Chuck, on our website?
Put it up. Yes.
Okay, I'll let you handle that. You can tell.
We have, well, hello. I know I haven't said
that. Yeah, I was about to say, I'm like, you've been super quiet. I'm like, I'm going to sit back like, wait, what?
I'm always multitasking.
No doubt. We can dig it, Charl.
So, yeah, you can catch us on Facebook at Unico Entertainment LLC. We have Instagram, but it is Urban Envy Movie.
Yeah, we're following you guys there.
Mm-hmm. Twitter as well. And I believe that would also be Urban Envy
Movie.
We're actually coming down the final stretch with Urban Envy because we've been working on this film so long, like so many years. People just don't know. It's new to y'all, but it's literally old to us.
Hey, don't take it away from me. I like it being new. All right, don't say it's old to you, please.
Yeah, but we know, you know, pre-production, post-production, editing, shooting, everything takes so long. Even just writing the screenplay, so it's a process.
He gave you the crash course, but we literally had to film this movie twice.
Wow.
Yeah.
Mm-mm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yikes. I would have been mad.
I mean, you're talking about at least 3 years to make this movie.
Right.
The computer crashed once we finished.
That happened when I finished my book, B. Like, I understand that. I was like, are you kidding me? Ooh. And had to rewrite from the halfway point all over again. But you know what? Sometimes I feel like the universe does that to us because it's like, you know what? You could do it a little bit better. You think it's good enough, but I think you could go a little bit harder. And so let me just snatch this away, and then you redo it, and then you're just like, you know what? I think the second part was actually better.
exactly what happened.
Yeah.
Like, she's on point, baby boy. She's on point.
Keep me knowing.
Yeah.
I love it.
We want lots of people to give feedback on the movie because we've got some very interesting comments. In fact, we did a red carpet premiere here once. We did it, you know, years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And an elderly lady walked up to me and socked me in the arm because of the character that I played. True story.
She took it too personally.
I'm like, yeah. I'm like, wait,
she came
up and
said,
hey, man, you need to come to Detroit real quick?
You?
I said, we can go handle her real quick.
And when she was seeing a what you call that? One of those heavy bags?
Yeah.
And an umbrella. So
oh, wow. She sounds like a Tyler Perry character.
So I think once you see the movie, you'll get a better understanding why she did that.
Yeah. So, that's funny.
Happy with the product.
So you were a really bad guy. I can't wait to see. Definitely got to check it out before I end my Amazon Prime, which is shortly this week. Trying to get it all in. I just ordered some groceries from the pantry. I was like, what else we need for Prime? What else we need, Prime? Any last call? Gotta eat.
You know what? I think we should stage a trip to come out to New York.
Yes.
Meet you guys.
That's what I'm talking about. Yes.
We would love that.
Like-minded individuals, so we can do anything.
Yeah, and you can finally drag Kier back to New York. You guys can all come in.
If Kier said anything to you about doing a screener, because he's always pushing to get a screener done.
No, but I'm sure if he wants to, he knows that we can get it done. So we can definitely speak behind the scenes because I'm getting ready to help him with the upcoming Kwanzaa Film Festival. So I would love to help you guys get that done if you want to do one in New York City. We could get it popping.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and I think we could do a little VPR media. What
of
you
course,
think,
why
FMI?
Not? Why
you know
not? We here.
Yeah,
right.
A little VPR presentation, maybe a little panel. Sit down and talk to the creators and get to know a little something. Get some questions from the audience.
You talking
you
about
guys
you,
like
you,
that?
You talking about you know talking about that? I'm trying to get in one of these films real quick. I'm
Listen,
trying to be,
we'll talk about that myself. Behind the scenes, FMI. Mm,
all right, you're right.
Got to get in this way and then go the other way.
Yeah, I was about to say. You know, I want to see
hey,
how
you
I look.
Know what? Anything's possible.
Absolutely.
For a reason. And we're always looking for new talent, new faces, because there are not a lot of people here with that rich New York accent.
Right.
I like it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Oh, that's good. No, I actually that's act, crazy. Though. I'll send you some stuff. No, like, no funny shit.
Like, no funny shit.
Yeah. Yeah, I can dig it.
Yeah. Okay. I love it. Everything happens for a reason.
It does.
I think we can make some things happen. I can't tell you how happy I am to be doing what I'm supposed to be doing.
Yes.
Finally in life.
Absolutely. And we are so proud of you for doing that. We need more men like you guys, more individuals that are saying, you know what, this is my passion, because this is what we need to be teaching our children. This is what we need to be teaching the younger generation,
yeah.
So that they're not walking around so miserable and unhappy. A lot of people are so unhappy and they don't even
and
lost, and they don't realize it's just because you're not living in your purpose. And so you're just unhappy for no reason.
I just always think of it like this. I want kids to understand that if you come from a bad neighborhood,
mm-hmm.
you don't got to do music or basketball.
Yeah.
Because that's the first thing I was exposed to.
Right.
And it
that's
sucks,
your way
you know what
out.
I'm saying? And mm-hmm. it was this, and that's what I want to make sure every kid that comes across VPR, you know,
mm-hmm.
and anything that I do. But yeah, man, that's that.
Yeah, any opportunity that you want is in front of you, but you do have to take the responsibility and accountability and go get it. And I think that you guys are definitely living proof of that. So we appreciate it. I can't wait to cue it up tonight after physical therapy. I'm going to be watching Urban Envy. So you
well,
can expect my comments. Say
yeah,
what?
Listen to the music. The soundtrack is so awesome, and they're all local Detroit artists.
Oh, that's
I'm
dope.
I'm not talking trash. I'm talking, listen, when you hear the soundtrack, the people at the red carpet, they wanted to buy the soundtrack that night.
Nice.
So it's not like a typical rah, 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 but I'll let you decide.
Well, I know anything that came my way through Kier is not going to be a typical anything. So I have high expectations based off of everybody that he places in my lap. And I think he has high expectations of me, which is why he connects me to these individuals. So I already know.
He holds you in a very high regard.
And I appreciate that. And likewise.
He knows everybody.
He does.
He knows everybody under the sun. Like,
he really does.
I don't know how he knows it.
One way or another, he knows him. Shout out to Kier.
He's a lot older than he says, I think. There's no way
he's like 112.
Yeah. Very wise.
Very.
Yeah, I like Kier. He's a good guy.
Yeah, he is. Yeah, we appreciate you guys, and make sure that you guys go and check out Urban Envy Movie on Amazon Prime. Go and follow them. Once again, what was the entertainment company?
Inico.
You can go straight to our
INIKO.
Yeah, InicoFilms.com.
InicoFilms.com.
Currently, okay. We got the link to the trailer and also to the movie in our press kit.
Awesome. Awesome sauce. Well, I'm excited. Make sure you guys go and check out the movie. And we appreciate you, Charl and Coke, for being with us today. We will definitely talk behind the scenes, because I would love to have you guys in New York City, and VPR can host you here and some other things. So we'll talk behind the scenes. And FMI, you want to get into some more music before we give Cassidy and Rampage a call?
Yeah, why not? Why not? Guys, thank you for calling in. We appreciate you.
Yeah. Have a great day, fellas.
All right, thank you so much.
You're so welcome. Bye-bye.
Okay.
Fucking the work, huh? Fans be plugging their shirts. Check them, I know what it's worth, huh? Coaching notes, mafiosa. Bread around, I keep a toaster. Y'all know I can't shoot and drive. That's why I roll with a chauffeur. Mountains and white, you can ski on, huh? She wants to lean, Dion, huh? Take a soda, make it neon, huh? I just be macking my G on, huh? Money so tall, you can lean on. All my eyes look like it's speed on. Police stop bugging my G-moms. Brooklyn, we here, I'm the phenom. Send you a pack, don't open it up, cause me on some transported shit. Crib in the boon, is trying to make a movie. Boy, my camcorder lit. Tell my moms that I do construction to keep my hand on the bricks. I supervise while all the workers make sure the stamps getting lit. Yeah.
Pocket chip and hardcore trafficking.
Yeah.
Buy and sell, yeah, I got clientele.
Yeah.
Pocket chip and hardcore trafficking. Yeah. Buy and sell, yeah, I got clientele.
Hold on.
Yeah. What the fuck's a drug? Drake this from the Mexicans. Sell it like the way we don't Lexington. Package move through traffic, meet them checks coming in. Script's not for play, this for medicine. Make your money all day, my regimen. Getting rid of weight till we skeletons. We be catching planes in the forest, switching lanes. Fly them out your way, we got pelicans. I was making plays straight out the shirt. But no cinnamon. Pocket chip and hardcore trafficking.
Yeah.
Buy and sell, yeah, I got coin too.
Yeah.
Pocket chip and hardcore trafficking. Yeah. Buy and sell, yeah, I got coin too.
Hold on.
Yeah. What the fuck's a drug? Cause I've been counting money here around. VVS is round my collar, yeah, that's water. Platinum. Paranoia got me spies and y'all bitches, it's just average. I birth, you need a carriage, so my soul, this is a marriage. On the way, I'm on the way. Yeah, I'm on the way, I'm on the way. Your energy is stressing me, I know y'all bitches envy me. Your energy is stressing me, I know y'all bitches envy me. Your energy is stressing me, I know y'all bitches envy me. Your energy is stressing me, I know y'all bitches envy me. I roll my weed, high like high, I'm on my own. Plug twice. I got my fans up, they gon' throw their hands up. Yeah, I got my bands up, I'm gon' score like it was. Yeah, we stayed up too many nights. I'm on the way, I'm catching flies. Oh, your energy is stressing me, I know your bitches send me me. Your energy is stressing me, I know your bitches send me me. Your energy is stressing me, I know your bitches send me me. Your energy is stressing me, I know your bitches send me me. One time for these drugs, two time for the plug. 3 hours in some other life, babe, you gon' have to pack up. Yeah, I'm stressing, stressing, watching Instagram. Like how these niggas get 100 bands. Like how these bitches get 1,000 stands. When I go, you better clap your hands, yeah. Give me head, put me in a trance, yeah. Call them bro, they're not your mans, yeah. Think you, babe, you ain't in the plans, yeah. Know who run from where in the stands, yeah. Take a minute just to understand, yeah. Yeah, we did it with no upper hand. In your city, we are in demand, yeah. I am drugs, yeah, I am hands, yeah. Energy is stressing me, I know your bitches send me me. Yeah, energy is stressing me, I know your bitches send me me. Yeah, energy is stressing me, I know your bitches send me me. Yeah, energy is stressing me, I know your bitches send me me. I roll my weed high like high. I'm on my own, give me mine. I know you mad at life. I went to the plug twice. I got my fans up, they gon' throw their hands up. Yeah, I got my bands up, I'm gon' score like N1. Yeah, we stayed up too many nights. I'm on the way, I'm catching flies. Oh, your energy is stressing me, I know your bitches send me me. Your energy is stressing me, I know your bitches send me me. Your energy is stressing me, I know your bitches send me me. Your energy is stressing me, I know your bitches send me me. Way, I'm on the way, yeah, I'm on the way, I'm on the way. Your energy is stressing me, I know your bitches send me me. Your energy is stressing me, I know your bitches send me me. Your energy is stressing me, I know your bitches.
All right, y'all rocking with DJ FMI. We live here at VPR Radio. Hello?
Yo, 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 yo.
Yo, what up, Rampage?
There
how
we
you
go.
Doing?
We can hear you loud and clear, my brother.
As long as y'all can hear me clear, then we in there.
Oh, yeah, we all the way in
yo,
here.
He came in spitting bars that's off the rip. That's what we doing, Rampage?
Facts. So how have you been doing? What's been up?
You know, grinding. You
facts.
Know? Just grinding, keeping it moving, doing what I do.
Right.
You know what I mean? Just studio working on some new music, DJing all over the place.
Okay.
Radio station in the country. I'm
so you
I DJ as well.
I'm about to ask. I'm like, so right. You DJing plus you make it. All right, bro. You the cheat code. You the cheat code, bro.
Yeah.
They can't stop the grind because you pushing it no matter what.
Yeah.
Nah. But, you know, I don't know if people knew before I started rhyming and rapping, I was DJing a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? But, you know, I was DJing for a hobby. I just like DJing. So,
okay,
you know, and also, you know, I have a DJ crew called the Heat DJs.
So, oh, yeah. Okay.
Big up to the Will Money and big up to Money Green Marché and big up to my lovely publishers, MJ. You know what I'm saying?
No doubt. MJ is the plug. So, that's my girl.
Definitely.
Mm-hmm.
So what made you touch on becoming an artist? Because when you start off DJing, I know personally, I'm just like, what would get you in the studio to start recording? What motivated you to do that?
Well, you know, I deal with a lot of producers, and also I have a management company. Me and my partner, we have a management company, and I manage a couple of artists. So, you know, when I'm not doing my management company or I'm not DJing, then I go back to my first love, which is rapping. So
were you rapping first? Because I know you were part of Flip Moto. Were you doing DJ first?
No, I was actually trying to be a DJ first. But what people don't know, I used to DJ for Rod Digger.
Right.
Oh, gotcha. All right. So that's why we're tying in.
I only DJ for her for a minute, but I was. You know,
and then they pulled you in to be an artist, or how did that work out?
Nah. What happened was I always been rapping.
But yeah.
Before I started rapping, my mom's bought me two turntables, two Geminis, and two Gemini turntables and a mixer.
Yeah.
So, you know, she gave me like the start off kit. You know
right.
what I mean?
Of course.
You know, so I was rapping and DJing, but I was DJing before I was rapping.
Gotcha.
And then, you know, I just got serious with it, and, you know, I ran into my one of my cousins named Baxman, who's a producer who produced Wild for the Night. And he was like, yo, you know, come over and let's start doing some demos, man. I see you in the neighborhood. You battling everybody. you know, it's time to get real. But at the same time, he wasn't telling me that he was recording a lot of artists like Special Ed, Leaders of the New School, all these type of dudes. And, you know, I'm in the right place at the right time.
Mm-hmm.
He charging everybody in the neighborhood for studio time, but he never charged me.
Right.
So when he ever every time he had some free time, he would just tell me to come over, and I would just walk about 10 blocks to his house. I get there, and next thing you know, he got a fly beat on, and he was actually the first one that taught me some bars, how to put my rhymes in bars. So, you know, I learned a lot from Backspin the Vodka.
And when it,
and then, you know,
go ahead.
We started making demos, and then all of a sudden, I didn't know that he was recording my cousin, my other cousin, you know what I'm saying, which was Buster from Leaders of the New School.
Mm-hmm.
So one day he called me over there, and Buster was over there, and Buster was like, "Brack, I told you Ramp was my cousin." And then, you know, I've been on ever since.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Because it's always being at the right place at the right time.
And that's it, big is in this industry.
And knowing the right people.
Yeah.
Along knowing with the talent. Right, we talk about that all the time, and that's why it's important not to burn your bridges.
And years before that, you know, Buster was always, you know, he moved from Brooklyn to Long Island, and
mm-hmm.
we actually lived around the corner from each other. And yeah, Buster's my first cousin as well.
Right.
So,
your cousin.
So, you know, he lived around the corner from me, and, you know, we grew up as kids, man. We grew up as kids with each other. They just moved away.
Right.
And I stayed on the block. So, you know, being from the block of New York Avenue, and they was on Tilden and 31st.
That's crazy. That's why I was at
Brooklyn,
this
Brooklyn. Exactly.
Yeah, that's why I was at this morning. Actually, I drove from my cousin's house.
Yeah.
So I'm telling you, actually, I remember it like it was yesterday. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And what I loved about it was, you know, growing up as a kid, I remember seeing Special Ed on the other block. So if you check out Special Ed's Unsung, I'm all over it, because again, I used to battle Special Ed at this time before I really started blowing the spot. And that's my bro, man. Like, he used to test me all the time.
Right.
Back then, they didn't call me Rampage. He used to call me Roger Rabbit. I don't know what people call me.
Yeah. Don't call me Roger Rabbit no more. I'm a grown man now. You try that, you're going to go another way.
It's funny as hell.
You know, I used to see Special Ed. He used to walk, this kid with curly hair. He used to have a profile jacket.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't know what it was. I thought it was a Nautica jacket or a North Face jacket. But I seen this kid with this varsity jacket. And the next year, I was watching Video Music Box, and I seen I Got It Made, and then...
I'm looking at that song right now. That's the funny thing, too. I got it on YouTube, pulled up. I'm just like, because I listen to Special Ed.
So
shout out to Ralph McDaniels of Video Music Box.
Ralph, you know, he was on every tube in New York City, so that's all we had. That was BET, Video Music Box.
Of course.
Right, and we actually got to interview him a few weeks ago at the Rolling Loud pre-event, so that was pretty dope.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, Uncle Ralph kind of
influenced
a lot of that for me. And then, you know, I knew in my head when I was watching Special Ed, this is after Busta Move, watching Special Ed, this had to be 89.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sitting there like, wow, this is what I want to do. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm in the neighborhood, and we know the same people from the same neighborhood. We're from the same neighborhood, exactly the same neighborhood. And they were probably like 2-3 years older than me.
Right.
But every time I seen Special Ed, it was me, the kid, Phantasm, from the Cellar Dwellers. It was me, him, and one of my friends, Chris, who passed away. We used to see Special Ed late at night. On Fridays, I remember this, we used to stay up late at night. We on the block. We at the park either playing basketball or putting some smoke in the air. Special Ed running through the block.
Mm-hmm.
And then he seen us rapping. He like, yeah, because he was better at the time. He would come through, hit some bars with us, because he knows us from the neighborhood. And my older brother, Art, was always with him at all times. So I kind of knew him before the music. You know what I'm saying? We like know each other from school. And then what people don't know, Busta and Special Ed, we was all in the same school, but they was always 3 years or 2 years ahead of me. which was 181. And then we all went to Whitman, and then, you know, Buster had, he moved away, moved to Long Island. So, you know, when your family move away sometimes, it's always a distance. It's not
of course.
It was just, you know, we moved away. We ain't with each other every day like we used to. The next thing you know, I start doing demos with Backspin.
All right.
And my cousin is back in Brooklyn. We link back up again. He running with Leaders of the New School. So at the time, I'm like, man, I'm going with, you know.
You're around Elite.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm like, I'm not going to leave right now.
Right. And that's when you have to learn how to create those opportunities, because a lot of people, unfortunately, in this industry, and I'm sure you see this a lot as well, Rampage, you have people that are just stick around. And
hang around.
I call them like the get on crew.
You know what I mean?
They feel like if they stick around enough, even though they don't do anything, if they like, can I get you something? Or is this and that that they're going
to
get on?
You need me to roll up for you?
Right. No. Like I've been rolling for years. Why did you roll up for me? Yeah. You know?
Yeah.
But you actually got to put that work in. You know what I mean? And let them know that, hey, I'm a viable resource. I'm talented. I can do this and I can do that.
But not everybody's going to want you to shine either.
And this is how you've been able to keep longevity, because, I mean, you started working in the industry in what, the early 90s or so?
I want to say 88.
Okay.
You see what I'm saying? Like that's
when I was on my demo status.
Right. So we're talking 30 years plus. You know what I mean? And that says a lot.
89, right?
Right.
So I'm on some demo back and forth to Backspin's house. And then I didn't really put out my first record until 92, which was Beware the Ramsack. So between all of that, I was traveling with Lisa the New School. And then, you know, that they had it signed base. And then next year, you know, Bus was like, I'm starting Flip Mode. You in?
Right.
Like, of course, 100.
I exactly.
Like, what I loved about that is between 88 and 89, I'm on the way out of high school, so I just take some IGD and get out, because I was like, I ain't going to school if I got to be on the road with Leaders of the New School
right.
for weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks. So I had a chance to go on the road. My first show I ever did with them was Roanoke, Virginia. I'm traveling and I'm learning, and Buster put me on.
You're touching the bag.
Yeah.
And learn. and I got it. Like, I, you know, he let me see things
firsthand.
That, you know, that they was experiencing as leaders of the new school. And I was just there helping, moving, helping them with bags to their rooms and all that stuff. It's like, you know, being a roadie.
Right.
Of course, bro. Yep. You got to put in the work.
That's right. We've all had to.
I had to get in where I fit in.
Yeah, exactly. And, happily, right?
Loving those dudes, man, and learning a lot from the dudes. The first tour I've ever been on was Public Enemy.
Nice.
And Leaders of the New School was opening up for Public Enemy. And
that's an amazing experience. Like,
so I'm sitting there watching this. I ain't never been to Washington, D.C. ever. Or I ain't never been on the plane ever.
Right.
I've just been on the tour bus with Leaders of the New School, or the tour van with Brandon. And Brandon was the road manager at the time at Leaders of the New School.
Mm-hmm.
So back and forth from being with Leaders of the New School, I'm still recording records with Backspin. You know what I'm saying? So once Backspin caught me that day to come to his house, my whole life changed.
Right.
But then, you know, because that was my cousin, he made me work too. Him and Backspin was putting pressure on me. But you know what? Being both of them as my cousins, you know, and they've been really doing it years before me, they both saw something in me. You know what I'm saying? So it kind of rubbed off on me by learning studio stuff from Backspin, because they didn't have Pro Tools then. That was just straight ADAC. I was recording straight ADAC.
Right.
Backspin was, it was no Pro Tools. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
You know, he's showing me how to punch in. He's showing me how to make hooks. You know what I'm saying?
You know what's crazy?
So you got him from every end of the spectrum.
Rampage, I'm going to throw an idea at you.
You know what's crazy? Everybody was coming out of Backspin crib at that time. I used to see RZA, I used to see Dirty, I used to see MC Light, I used to see Link Q, I used to see Brother J,
X-Clan, I used to see a lot of people coming out of Backspin Crib.
Right.
And every time they came out of Backspin Crib, he would call me and say, you got 2 hours to get to my house and record whatever you want to record. Man, I was on that train.
Yo, I'm telling you, Rampage, you need to put this in a book. Because I'm looking at it like, if you did that, you know, people would be.
Actually, I'm writing a book right now.
See, there you go.
I'm writing a book right now called Rules, Levels, and Decisions. It's about, you know, motivating people. This first one is being about motivating people because we need to be motivated. A lot of us is not motivated. We say we motivated, but we ain't motivated.
Agreed.
We only get motivated when we see other
people doing
something. And then now we're motivated.
I agree.
And it only lasts for a short period, too. Some people, just, you'll see it and be like, oh, now I'm going to do something. And then be like, psst.
I agree.
Nah, we don't coulda, woulda, shoulda.
No, so not around here. I love it.
It's like, so in this book I'm putting together, I just want to touch people. And I don't know if you follow me on Instagram, but every day I put out something that's positive.
Well, tell everybody that's listening where they can follow you.
Well, they can follow me at The Real Rampage or Rampage the Last Boy Scout.
Right.
Those are my two pages that I actually got 4 pages, Michelle Mathis, and I got Heat DJ number 1. But my Rampage, the Last Boy Scout page, and my At the Real Rampage page, send out positive messages. Just as long as I've been on the gram, I just sending out positive messages.
And we love that.
I get between 2,000 or 1,000, or just maybe 2,000 a day or 1,000 a day of DMs of people saying, yo, you be hitting on point for what you're saying. So, you know, I constantly did that. So over the years, I've been on the gram. I just took everything that I started writing on the gram and started forming it as a book. So I've been working on it actually for 6 years. So I'm almost close to complete.
Completing it.
Well, that's great. We definitely want to hear more about that. So maybe, you know, as we get into 2020, and you're in New York, we can actually have you in the studio and we can be talking about the book because it sounds like it's going to be exactly to the VPR Radio.
You feel me?
And it's not
going to
be boring either.
Of course not.
I never wrote a book ever in my life, but writing raps is like writing a book. That's how I think. It's just a long ass. But I'm not.
It's different as a book writer and a writer. It is different. But I can dig it. I mean, if you're a writer, you're a writer. Period. You know what I mean?
But I got a million bars, so
right.
It's just
putting it all together and formulating it.
I'm about to sum it all together. I'm about to really, really finish it. You know.
I can dig it.
You know.
So
I'm into books. I'm into film and television. I got cartoons coming. You know, big up to my dude, Tommy the Animator. I got like 3 cartoons I've done, you know, just testing the waters because I want to get into animation and things like that besides being an MC.
So you got MC, too much underneath your belt, man. You got the music on lock. You're an artist yourself.
I just got a lot on my mind.
I see that. You're doing.
I can understand
you're
it.
You're doing it, my brother. You sitting here writing a book.
I live the same way.
Yeah.
But listen, we are running. I hate to cut you, but we're running out on time, and I do want to get your brother Cassidy on the phone as well. If you could bring him up for us, that would be great because we are about to be off air at 1 p.m. and we just want to ask him a few questions before we get off. And once again, where can they find you again?
At The Real Rampage on Instagram and Rampage the Last Boy Scout.
No doubt.
Instagram. Hold on, let me call him right now.
In the meantime, I'm going to play your track real quick. If you're my, you should actually get into that.
Yeah, for sure.
All right.
Let's get it. Let me in.
We had prepared a special mix to show our appreciation for your support. Thank you, DJs.
Blackwater?
I know the streets can't stand it. I'm back on my diggable planets. Y'all don't really want the static. This one is really sporadic. I'm romancing my stone.
Yeah, what's going on?
Look like Cleopatra Jones.
Let me fade this out real quick.
We got him.
Yeah, we have you back live on VPR Radio. What's going on?
Hello?
Hello? Yo.
VPR Radio, you're on the line. Is this Cassidy?
Yeah, what's
What's up with y'all? How y'all coming?
Oh, we're feeling great. We're at the end of our show, and we you know have had some great guests. So this is definitely a phenomenal way to end it, having you on the line. How's your day going so far?
Well, I know disrespect to y'all, but guess I don't know who they was, but I guess y'all saved the best for last. It's the end of the show.
Let me drop the hook. Yo, it's early, but Cassidy came great. With the energy.
Listen, well, you better speak to your bro, Rampage, because we tried to get you on at like 11:38, I believe it is, that we called, and we got dropped. But we're live on air, so you know, it's not like we can wait for phone issues and stuff.
Just so you don't know, you rocking with DJ FMI, my brother, and of course,
Qianathegoddess all day.
And we're happy to have you on VPR Radio.
Yes.
So, how's everything with you? I appreciate you, my brother. We did try to get you on earlier, but, you know, things happen, you know, communications, whatever the issue may be. So, what's going on in your life, Mr. Cassidy?
I'm living life, enjoying life, man. Making music. I got a new project out called Numbers. It's on all of the platforms. A new single called More Love featuring Lil Mama on all platforms. Another record called It's a Rap that's more recent that I just dropped on all platforms. I got a video debuting on World Star Saturday. Top of the page is going to be a movie. It's called Another Plan.
Okay.
You see... Go ahead, Cassidy. Go ahead.
I just wrote my first movie. I'm going to go into shooting in the next couple of months.
That's dope.
I'm just finished writing the script, casting who I'm going to put in the movie and who I think should be a part of the whole project, getting that together. So I should have that done real soon.
Okay.
Got the clothing line is available for everybody around the world at hoodg.com right now. So if you want some Barz's back gear, whether it's a t-shirt, hoodie, jacket, dad hat,
Cassidy's busy.
Yeah,
Cassidy's big busy.
Love it.
The Cassidy collection got a lot of designs available. So, working on my artist, my sidekick, my partner in crime. I'm working on her project, Ray J Ratchet. She made her debut on the Numbers project that I'm telling you about. That's available on all platforms.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah. She's on a few records on that.
And she's your artist.
Yeah, so we working on her project right now.
It should
be done real soon. Single should be out real soon. There's no date set yet, but it's coming ASAP. And I've been doing a lot of production on my social media. I've been putting up a lot of the production that I've been making. I've been locked in.
You see,
really going in and making beats. So the last single that I actually released is called Barry Time.
Okay.
Barry Time. And I produced the record and I wrote the record. I did everything. It's all me. And it's like sort of like being selfish, but, you know, in a different way. It's like all doing it from the muscle.
Of course.
So that's what I did with the last record, and I've been doing a lot more production. Get my catalog up, so you should have me on a lot more of my piece soon.
I love
and
that.
And other artists. I'm going to be placing some music for other artists, too, so...
Yo, you're doing it all, my brother.
I'm working hard. I got a lot going on. Y'all asked me what I was
doing. I know.
Yeah. this is exactly what we wanted you to lay it out.
Of course, because everybody needs to hear that. Because I do pay attention to you a lot. I'm not going to lie. And you touch on the Barz Up, right? Speaking about Barz Up, you see hip-hop right now. And, watching you and everything and the music that you do, how do you see yourself in hip-hop now till the earlier, you know, 90s and 2000s?
Now, I'm way more of a factor than I was in the early 2000s or in the 90s because I was young, had less information, less experience, and was capable of doing less things.
Right.
And my focus was more narrow. Like, when you're young, you don't fully understand the business. You just want to get lit. It's like,
I
want to get lit.
It's true.
I didn't have any real bills. I didn't even know what adult life was really like when I first got my first record deal.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I was coming from high school with no responsibilities. So
right.
That's crazy because
it's easy to get caught up.
To being home, having kids. Like, my son right here in front of me, taller than me, bigger than me, looking down on me.
Right.
That's wild. Different.
The same son that I said, my bill's coming too soon. My son will be too soon.
Yeah.
That means he was one then.
Yeah.
Now, he's taller than me. He just turned 16.
Right.
So, a lot changed in my life. I matured a lot, learned a lot more, and I'm capable of doing a lot more. So, that's the difference. And
And I got a lot more to bring to the table from having experience to the next generation, the up and coming artists, the dudes that's younger than me,
yep,
that need to learn more. I got a lot that I could bring to the table and teach.
And that's great, and that's the because they need
the
that.
Video that I'm releasing on Saturday, I told you that's dropping on Worldstar, Never Plan is dropping.
Yeah.
It's actually like I'm in a classroom, and it's a lot of students, and it's like I'm the teacher, and I'm teaching the class.
And where did you shoot that?
That's a metaphor off of it. I mean, that's like a flip, a metaphor and a play off the fact that I'm teaching these artists and these new dudes that's up and coming how you're supposed to carry it.
Mm.
You see, not a lot of
passing
artists.
Passing the
even,
torch.
Yeah, not a lot of artists. They don't want to do that. A lot of artists don't want to even spend time, you they know, don't. Showing the way.
And it's so important because a lot of the younger artists don't even know how to recognize and pay homage to those that have paved the way for
of
them.
Of course.
So it's imperative because, A, you're making that connection with them directly, you know, and then B, you're educating them so that you can hopefully help them so that they don't make the same mistakes. You know, our things when we're helping and trying to teach others is to give them a heads up. Mm-hmm. You know, hey, we did this already. You don't have to fall down and bust your ass this way when you can do it this way. You can be smarter. So the faster someone can mature and just be hip to it, the better.
Trying to tell a grown man what to do. You know, yeah, how they feel. They feel like they know everything.
It's true.
Information is important, but if you know the information and you know what people went through, then mm-hmm. when you're next up, you can better yourself. You can put yourself in a better position if you know your history.
Absolutely. If you're open-minded.
Know the history so you could know. But if a lot of artists is fronting,
you ain't lying.
Let's touch on that.
They might be in a real bad predicament. They might, you know what I mean?
By bad predicament, you're touching on like deals and stuff like that?
Well, yeah, deals, but just in life, period.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I mean, they might be barely staying above water.
Right.
But because they connected to some type of machine,
yeah,
it makes them look like they super rich.
And right, it's true.
Super wealthy. And,
yeah, and social media has a great way of doing that as well. But, yeah.
And the machine and the people that's behind them is leaking it and is presenting them like that. So mm-hmm. a regular fan that might not be informed to have a lot of information might look at that person being super rich and having nothing to worry about.
Mm-hmm.
So their dream is to be just like that artist,
mm-hmm.
not knowing what that artist is really going through, the type of paper that artist is really playing with.
Yeah.
If you knew the real information, then the decision that you might decide to make might be something different.
That's right.
So, you know what I mean? It's not about... Nowadays, with the technology we got, information is available. You can easily get information, but all of it is not pure information. All of it is not true.
That's
right. A lot of it is just to manipulate you and keep you confused.
Mm-hmm.
So it depends on what type of information that you're taking in to determine what type of artist you're going to be.
Yep.
And a lot of people get the culture confused with the business. The best thing that you do as far as business go is not always the best thing to do as far as the culture go. It's just two separate things. Sometimes you got to break rules to the culture to make the best business decision.
Amen to that. You better drop those gems, Cassidy.
Some people is in it for the culture because they love hip-hop.
Yeah.
Some people was just in it for a check because they seen that was a way to get bread.
Right.
So the decisions that somebody that makes that love the culture is not going to be the same as somebody that don't even care about the culture. All they care about is the check.
That's right.
So, but... from the outside looking in, everybody categorized all of them people as the same.
Mm-hmm.
And you look at all of the decisions and everything that everybody doing is the same.
That's right.
So that's why I'm here, to let people know the difference between that.
Mm.
To separate the two. Not
Cassidy,
saying they both don't need to exist and there's no reason for having both of them, but people just need to know the difference in between the two.
Amen.
And the difference in between two type of different artists. An artist that's connected to a machine and an artist that's doing it more independent and just surviving off the strength of the skill.
That's right.
Yo, you see,
that's what I'm talking about.
Yo, the growth is crazy. Seeing you in the early 2000s and where you are now, and seeing what you're doing as far as with the music, with teaching people the industry and teaching people life.
Yeah,
it's crazy. I'm sitting back here right now. I'm like, yo, this need to be heard, Cassidy. You know what I'm
that's
saying?
That's a fact.
Like what you're doing is literally legendary, my brother. That's dope. I ain't gonna hold
Thank you, man.
Of course.
Yeah, we definitely want to get you on air again. Hopefully we can arrange to do it soon because we want a lot more time with you. And I know that we're winding down. So I do want to have you let everybody know where they can follow you, where they can learn more. I know you're getting ready to shoot your movie. Give us a little bit more detail about that. How can everyone follow along on your journey?
We really early with the movie, but the movie is called Bigger Business. Mm-hmm. That's what I'm gonna let you know now, and that's what it's called. But if you want to get in contact with me, social media is the best way. You know, phone numbers and addresses change, but social media normally stay the same. Okay. So that's the best way to get in contact with me, Cassidy_Larceny, LARSINY. It's the blue check, so you'll know it's official. And if you're trying to do business or book me or lock me down for a show or features or anything like that, hit the email shitlitty@gmail.com. Those are the two best ways to get in contact with me, and we could do business and make it happen.
Okay,
and
great.
I can't wait to get back on the show so we could talk some more because I got a lot of information to pass off.
Yes, and we can tell.
Just keep me posted and let me know.
For sure. I'll lock in with MJ. Brother. We also want to get your new singles that you have because I know she got us Get to a Cell, but we want all your music. You know, we love to support those that are out doing it and working hard and especially appreciative of the fact that you are educating the next generation. So we appreciate you, Cassidy. Keep being great, and we'll definitely have you back on air soon.
Thank you, my brother. I appreciate
you. Thank you. Y'all do the same. Keep doing y'all thing. And until the next time, appreciate the love.
Absolutely. Thank you. Enjoy your day.
Thank you.